Today's scripture from Luke again reflects Luke's fascination with disadvantaged people. Jesus' first visitors are not ambassadors, dignitaries, or wealthy landowners. The first to pay him homage are simple shepherds, minimum wage workers in the ancient agrarian economy. They have little to no status in the world. They are the humble and the poor, whom God is now raising up to receive heavenly messages and an audience with the great King. This theme recurs as the story continues.
8 days after his birth, the baby was circumcised in keeping with Jewish religious requirements, and he was named Jesus, the name the messenger had given the baby before his conception in Mary's womb. After Mary had observed the ceremonial days of postpartum purification required by Mosaic law, she and Joseph brought Jesus to the temple in Jerusalem to present Jesus to the Lord. They were fulfilling the Lord's requirement that every firstborn Israelite male will be dedicated to the Eternal One as holy. They also offered the sacrifice required by the law of the Lord, 2 turtle doves or 2 young pigeons.
While fulfilling these sacred obligations at the temple, they encountered a man in Jerusalem named Simeon. He was a just and pious man, anticipating the liberation of Israel from her troubles. He was a man in touch with the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit had revealed to Simeon that he would not die before he had seen the Lord's anointed one. The Spirit had led him to the temple that day. And there he saw the child Jesus in the arms of his parents, who were fulfilling their sacred obligations. Simeon took Jesus into his arms and blessed God.
And Simeon, who had been told he would not die before he saw the Lord's anointed one, held the baby Jesus and said, "Now, Lord and King, you can let me, your humble servant, die in peace. You promised me I would see with my own eyes what I am seeing now. Your freedom raised up in the presence of all peoples. He is the light who reveals your message to the other nations, and he is the shining glory of your covenant people, Israel."
His father and mother were stunned to hear Simeon say these things. Simeon went on to bless them both, and to Mary in particular, he gave predictions.
Simeon said, "Listen, this child will make many in Israel rise and fall. He will be a significant person whom many will oppose. In the end, he will lay bare the secret thoughts of many hearts. And a sword will pierce even your own soul, Mary."
At that very moment, an elderly woman named Anna stepped forward. Anna was a prophetess, the daughter of Phanuel of the tribe of Asher. She had been married for 7 years before her husband died, and now a widow to her current age of 84 years. She was deeply devoted to the Lord, constantly in the temple, fasting and praying. When she approached Mary, Joseph, and Jesus, she began speaking out thanks to God, and she continued spreading the word about Jesus to all those who shared her hope for the rescue of Jerusalem.
This is the word of the Lord.
It's a morning where one could say Merry Christmas and almost Happy New Year. We're in an interesting time of the Christian year where these two things come together and we find ourselves still in Christmas time, or what the Christian year calls Christmas tide. And I think it's wonderful that we have one more Sunday to sing all the glorious Christmas carols and songs that tell the story of Christ's birth so beautifully. This is not a typical passage or scripture story that we hear at this time of year. Sometimes this is Epiphany Sunday or another Sunday where we hear about Herod's outrageous action of killing children and anger and hostile action. In other places, wise men may be arriving this morning and sharing their gifts and going home yet another way. But this morning in Luke's gospel, we hear a different story, a story that's only told in the Gospel of Luke. Rituals and traditions are a part of this story today, a part of Luke's gospel message to the Jewish people of his community. Rituals, traditions, and religious practices are important. They play a role in our lives that anchor us and remind us of what is important in our life and in our Christian living. For example, our Advent candle wreath. Every year we drag this out and someone almost always calls and says, do you know where the candles are that go with it, or where the pieces are, the fix on it? So that we can practice lighting the candles every Sunday, the candles of peace and hope and joy and love that lead us to Christ's birth through the Advent season. Then we gather together as ritual and worship on Christmas Eve to celebrate the birth of Jesus and his life, ministry, death, and resurrection at the table of our Lord, the table of remembrance, the table of forgiveness and fulfillment. The words are beautifully written across our communion table to remind us that this is a ritual, a practice that we need to do and that we need to continue to be a part of. There are some who attend our Christmas Eve service because they love our yearly ritual of lighting candles, standing around in a circle in the sanctuary together with faces all aglow with the candles lit. For one, I know this is about the only time of year that this person will attend a worship service. They love the meaning behind lighting a candle in the greatness of gathered community and singing together in the round, silent night, holy night. All is calm, all is bright. I was really proud of us this year. We actually got all the candles lit in the room before we finished singing the song. Another ritual we practice, much like Mary and Joseph in Luke's gospel, is the presentation of our own children in our holy temple, in this sanctuary. We too bring our children into the sanctuary so that parents can dedicate themselves to God and their children to God, to promise to bring them up in the ways of God and nurture them in the Christian love and the help of this congregation together, to raise them in the love of Christ and to encourage their discipleship and to live their lives accordingly. However, thankfully, we do not charge anyone a fee, and we don't ask anyone to bring their pigeons or doves or lambs or whatever a family might be able to afford. Here at Prairie, a ritual practice I was not accustomed to is when a person is baptized. We have a practice of a family coming forward and lighting the candle on the altar table for their child or family member who has invited the light of Christ into their lives. Every time so far that I've been a part of putting those candles on the table, I have done it wrong. I put the wrong candles out, or I don't have the right one to light the candle, and I'm quickly corrected that we don't have the right candles out. You know, the ones that we always use for baptism rituals. Rituals, customs, religious laws require certain elements, expected things to happen or to be said when we participate in these special moments. Mary and Joseph, faithful to the law and to the customs and rituals of their day, go to Jerusalem as they were to do, or as customary when the time came for them to do accordingly to the law. The law that says, as it is written in the law of the Lord, every firstborn male shall be designated as holy to the Lord. And they offered a sacrifice according to that which had been stated. Mary didn't receive a bouquet of flowers like we give mothers. And Jesus did not receive his first children's Bible. Instead, the new parents paid for their blessing of their child. As good, faithful Jewish parents, they had more than likely seen this religious practice take place in the past. Perhaps as other family members had done the same for their children. Or perhaps observing this ritual of blessing when gathered at the temple with others. It was a sacrificial moment for Mary and Joseph to give an offering of two birds, as poor as they were. And even more so as they handed over their baby boy to the Lord. But what happened next did not follow the customary ritual blessing. In fact, the story goes that the child's father and mother were amazed at what was said. When Simeon blessed them and said to his mother Mary, "This child is destined for the falling and the rising of many in Israel, and to be opposed so that the inner thoughts of many will be revealed, and a sword will pierce your own soul too." What did Simeon mean? The lyrics and notes to the Christmas song, "Mary, Did You Know," ring loudly in this moment. Mary, did you know that your baby boy will one day walk on water? Did you know that your baby boy will save our sons and daughters? Did you know that your baby boy has come to make all things new? This child that you delivered, this child will deliver you. Mary, did you know that your baby boy will give sight to a blind man and that your baby boy will calm a storm at sea? Did you know that your baby boy has walked where angels trod? And when you kiss your baby gently on his cheek, that you are kissing the face of God. Mary, did you know that the blind will see, the deaf will hear, and the dead will live again? The lame will leap, the dumb will speak the praises of the Lamb. Mary, did you know? Did you know that this baby boy is the Lord of all creation? And did you know that this baby boy will one day rule the nations? Mary, did you know that this sleeping child that you are holding is the great I Am? What did Simeon mean? And why was Anna the prophetess now praising God at this strange thing that Simeon had said? What was she saying about their child, that Jesus was born for all who were far away and near? What was Simeon saying? We have been given a great gift. It's one that causes us to sing as well, to draw into the sanctuary together in ritual formation and sing the praises of this child that is born. This child that causes Simeon to sing a song that is sang as ritual practice in the Benedictine communities. Master, now you are dismissing your servant in peace, for my eyes have seen your salvation, which you have prepared in the presence of all peoples, a light for revelation to the Gentiles and for glory to your people Israel. In this holy moment, guided and led by the presence of the Holy Spirit and the obedience of God's faithful servants, we discover that this holy child, born unto us, God with us, is for all people, for the young and for the old, for Jews and Gentiles, for the poor and for the widowed. And we are invited into the glory of God's redemptive story and song to sing out in our own human participation. As we prepare to face yet another year's arrival tomorrow at midnight, rather than make a resolution, I wonder what it would mean for each of us to take up a daily ritual and practice of our own, to give ourselves to the Christ child in greater obedience to that which God has birthed into the world. Perhaps righteousness and greater devotion to sharing peace, hope, joy, and love in all the many colorful and creative, imaginative ways that we can bring it about. Or perhaps taking up a more intentional prayer life, and perhaps even trying a little bit of fasting, making worship not only a Sunday event, but a daily event in order to live more deeply in tune with the Holy Spirit, who lives and breathes and dances among us. Numerous times over the past couple of weeks, I've heard people say, I don't know how people make it. I don't know how they get by if they don't know the Lord. What do people do who don't know Jesus, who don't know the love and comfort and peace of Christ living in us and amongst us? How is their pain and sorrow dealt with? It's a great question when we know the answer, when we hold the Christ child ourselves and have the ability to share God's generosity and abundance of great love in a hurting, suffering world. Christ is the gift of peace and light here on earth as in heaven above us. Let us be generous in sharing this gift of God's great love. It is a gift that keeps on giving. It requires no batteries. We may perhaps need recharging and refueling, thus needing Christ even more. Let us be faithful. Let us be obedient as Christ's servants, given this great gift of love. Amen.